hundreds of pressure tubes, thousands of columns and a height of 8 stories. These are just a few of the RBMK's numbers. If you ask yourselves, how the hell did this giant work? The answer is simple. Cheaply. Hey guys, we see that you liked the previous three episodes very much, so today we are continuing this subject. These last times we spoke about the RBMK history and today will not be any different. But however the three first parts were more or less technical, this episode will be mostly about how the RBMK was designed. More numbers, more reasons behind them, more technical talk. Some months ago we prepared a general video about the RBMK reactor which had some flaws. Today I will make sure it will be corrected. So, here we go. RBMK Nuclear Reactor History Part 4. Big, powerful and cheap. Let's sum up the previous episodes, just so you know what you could miss. The first one was about the pre-RBMK story. How and why was it developed, who was involved, and what the overall situation in the Soviet Union was at that time. It's important for you to understand the context of what we told you later. The second one focused on Leningrad's reactor, which was the first RBMK to be commissioned. We gave you a deeper context of how and why this design was flawed. In the third one, we explained how the questions about the RBMK arose in the Soviet Union's academic society. How were they handled and what was the outcome of Leningrad's meltdown. So this time, let's focus mostly on the reactor itself. You probably already know that the RBMK was not the best nuclear reactor design. Its plans were drawn quickly and had to include shortages of many compounds, materials and technology that were common in the rotten West. RBMK was supposed to be an opus magnum of the USSR's nuclear dreams. And they were huge. Having to compete with Americans in every field, the RBMK history is just one of many similar examples of how the Soviet Union tried to show everyone in the world that they are simply the best, the most advanced and, of course, the happiest place on Earth. Long story short, however, the American dream has definitely been different than imagined for many immigrants. Comparing the Soviet Union situation to the US in these times, so 70s and 80s, would be like kicking the person who's already lying on the ground. The propaganda of success is the domain of every nation, every country and basically every politician. But in the USSR it was absurd. The country that was supposed to be the greatest nation in history and ostentatiously bragged about its prosperity had also experienced famines, political repressions and mass murders. Empty shelves in most of the shops, excluding the ones for privileged people, were a sad testimony to how exactly prosperous the USSR was. In this situation, with the shortages of such proportion that building zones were sometimes literally abandoned due to lack of even basic materials, the RBMK was born. Having this in mind, everyone should ask themselves a question. How was it supposed to work? But somehow, it did. The RBMK was definitely a flawed project. The designing rush, as well as material and technological limitations, was condemning the ideals that were the reason behind constructing it. However, for spectators outside the USSR, the design could seem very impressive. It was a huge reactor, capable of producing enormous amounts of electricity, and it was constructed during hard times in the USSR. It was supposed to be the first commercial nuclear reactor in the Soviet Union, and the speed of creating it was astonishing. Today, after what happened in Chernobyl, we all know that it came with a grim price. But in the 60s and 70s it wasn't so obvious, especially since the whole project was strictly classified. To such a level, the operators of the first RBMK reactor didn't know about the flaws that resulted in the meltdown even after it happened. Despite the real reasons, faulty manufacturing was blamed, not the design itself. This was one of the reasons behind the Chernobyl disaster. and the design was just huge. It spoke to the minds of Soviet citizens. The biggest, the so-called most advanced, the best in the whole world. The reactor was hoped to become a savior of big areas of the USSR that didn't even have electricity at the time or had it, but with many limitations. The core itself was 7 meters high and 12 meters across, a cylindrical build, which gave roughly 450 cubic meters. The core was composed of 1700 tons of graphite blocks, which were stacked into almost 2500 separate columns. These columns contained over 1600 pressure tubes in which the fuel was held. Of course, simply speaking, as it is more complicated. The power was regulated by 211 control rods, which is a number to remember if you're interested in the Chernobyl disaster. This giant reactor, as any other, had to be additionally secured to contain the radioactivity that could escape during the fission process. To do that, the RBMK was designed to have outer layers. The reactor was surrounded by an annular tank which was pumped full of water. The tank was made of steel and then surrounded by another box, this time full of sand. But that's not the last part. The sandbox, if I may call it that way, was then covered by a concrete vault that was about 25 meters high. Additionally, there was also another part of the design that was composed of a mixture of iron and serpentinite. The second material is known for its capacity to slow down the neutrons. Above all of that, there was also Elena, or Structure E, which was a stainless steel drum and it worked as a lid. Also filled with serpentinite and other materials, Elena weighed an astonishing 2000 tons. Because of that, there were no additional hinges or other protection. Structure E was so heavy that gravity made sure it won't go anywhere. Elena was also the type of shield which was lifted during the explosion of reactor number 4 in Chernobyl. So imagine the surprise on the faces of the designers, not to mention the power plant workers. So now, you know how big it was. But the question is, why? As often happens, the size of the RBMK reactor and its protection layers was rather an outcome of the shortages and simplicity than the real goal of the designers. The graphite, stacked in columns, made the whole structure modular. This was a very important thing, because it made the RBMK possible to be assembled on site. Also, it made the reactor scalable, which meant it could be built even bigger and provide more electricity, if needed. The lead designer, Alexandrov, made the RBMK even less costly because of the safety containment. The design made it possible not to build a thick concrete structure, a dome, around the reactor. This would make the RBMK extremely costly, as it was way bigger than the Western reactors. They made a shortcut around this safety measure, which also made the design more susceptible to other, unforeseen situations. But that's a story for the next episode. I hope you enjoyed this video. If so, please leave a thumbs up and comment. If you want to suggest other subjects we should cover on our channel, feel free to do so here. That's it for today, guys. Stay safe, take care, and see you next week.